Good morning. How is everybody today? Am I on? I'm on. There we go. Good morning. And I'm so glad that you came out this morning to worship together with us. We have a couple special treats today. We have Aaron and Melissa Weil with us to lead us in worship, and they brought along their little daughter Elizabeth too to be with us today. Let's give them a hand as they come up here today to worship with us today.
All right, good morning. It's good to be up in War Road again, and happy Mother's Day to all you mothers out there. And if you can stand, go ahead and stand with us at this time as we start off with our first song, Open Up the Heavens.
Gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire will burn our hearts with truth. For the reason we're here, for the reason we're saved.
So this next song that we'd like to all sing together is actually on one of your banners this morning. Elizabeth picked that out. And, you know, the Bible says that God's mercies are new every morning. And aren't we glad for that? Because I'll tell you what, you know, with each and every new day, God starts with a clean slate. And, you know, we can just have another day. I don't care what you did yesterday. It's what you do today and tomorrow that can make up maybe for what you did yesterday. So walk in the Lord today. Walk in the power of his might today as we sing, Great is thy faithfulness.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be.
For now. Thank you.
Let's begin with prayer, and then I got a few announcements, and then we're going to recognize some moms here today. So, Father, we do thank you and praise you for the privilege we have today to come together as your people, to assemble together in this place, this day, and sing praises to you, to honor you, to glorify you, to lift your name up. And Lord, we know in your word that you've told us that if you be lifted up, that you will draw all men to yourself. And so, Father, I pray today that you would do that with each and every one of us. Draw us closer to you. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for the privilege you've given us to be here today. And I pray that you would be honored and glorified and blessed. And we praise you for all this. We ask in Christ's name. Amen. Well, welcome today to Woodland Bible Church. And if you are visiting with us, we're especially grateful that you've chose to come and to join us today for worship. And it is Mother's Day. So happy Mother's Day to all the moms. We're going to be recognizing you in just a moment. But if you've had an opportunity and you're a first-time guest or the first time here in a long time, there's a connection card in the bulletin that you might have received when you came in. Far right of that is a perforated section that we call the connection card. If you just fill that out and then have an opportunity, drop it in the box that's hanging on the wall out there that says offering box. We don't expect you or not obligating you to give in the offering. That's a place where those of us that call Woodland Bible Church home have of worshiping and serving through our gifts. But if you'll just drop that connection card in the box there, we would greatly appreciate that. The back of that card also talks about a prayer request. If you have a prayer request you'd like to share with the staff, we get together weekly for staff meeting and we pray over those requests and also pray for all the people in our church. So you can indicate that on the card as well. If you want it kept confidential, you can indicate that there too. Or if you just want to let us know something that's going on, it's not the connection card's not just for our guests, it's for all of us to use to communicate back and forth with the staff and the church. So that's available to you as well. So baccalaureate is next Sunday. So tonight there will not be any youth groups meeting here at the church at all, youth, junior high or senior high, because we want you to spend time with your moms today. But next Sunday, we have a special Sunday set aside to honor the graduates. And I think we have 6 graduates from our church that are graduating this year. And so we're going to have a special honoring of them next Sunday. And then following that service with a meal over in our fellowship hall that you're all invited to attend and enjoy. But then next Sunday evening at 7 o'clock is the baccalaureate service for Warroad Senior High School. The graduating seniors from Warroad High School are putting on this baccalaureate service. And we have a special guest speaker, none other than our very own Jonas Fisher, will be speaking at the baccalaureate service next Sunday evening. So I encourage you, if you want to come out to that next Sunday evening at 7 o'clock. And then I think there's one more announcement. Yes, if there's any other announcements that you'd like to know about what's going on with our church, you can check us out at our Facebook page, and we'd appreciate that. So at this time, I do want to honor all of our mothers. We have a special little gift that we'd like to give you. So if you're a mom here today, a mother, grandmother, if you would just stand so that we can recognize you, and we have some ladies that are going to be helping us give out some gifts. And I'm sorry, it's not chocolate this year. I know. I got to thinking, I'm not doing you a very good service by spiking your glucose levels. So, but it is a nice little gift. It's a little keychain. Ladies, you can just go ahead and start passing those out to any of the ladies that are standing up. A little token of our appreciation. We owe you so much more than this little gift, but we appreciate you as moms. And I would just encourage you to continue to stand even after you receive your gift, because I'm going to pray for you in a moment. But it's a little keychain, and then attached to that little box is also a bookmark. It's a magnetic bookmark. You can open that up and use it to bookmark in your Bible where you're reading or any other book that you're reading. So just a little token of our appreciation of you, keychains and a little bookmark, because we do want to appreciate you and honor you as mothers today. So I'll give these ladies a little bit of time here to pass all those out, and then in a moment I will pray for all of you. So if you're in the back and you're waiting, they're coming. While they're doing that, let's, guys, give, and others here today, give our mothers a hand. They are special to us. Okay, I think they're just about done. Let's go to the Lord and ask his blessing upon our moms today. Father, once again, we thank you and praise you for the privilege that you've given to each of us to have moms in our lives. And Lord, I thank you especially for these moms that are standing here today. Mothers that have raised their kids or are in the process of raising their kids, or maybe they're grandmothers now and maybe their kids are all grown. And Father, I just want to thank you for each and every lady that's here that's a mom. God, what a special treat to have them with us today. And Lord, I pray that as we pray for them, that God, you would bless them especially. as we honor them, Lord, with this little token of our appreciation, that, Lord, they would go out of here today feeling special and honored for the role that you've called them to in motherhood. And Lord, we just thank you and praise you for each and every lady here today and ask that you bless them. And we do all this in Christ's most precious and holy name. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated, ladies. This time I'm going to turn it back over to Aaron and Melissa as they continue to lead us in worship today.
All right, if you can stand with us again. We're going to stand in the love of Jesus this morning. So hope you can sing that with us.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when heartache comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, no, I won't be shaken, 'cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Yeah. Shame no longer has a place to hide.
We're gonna switch two songs in the bulletin because we had this for the last song, but we found out she might not be back from Sunday school, so, and she really wanted to, children's church, yeah. So she's gonna sing this one with us. It's called Who You Say I Am. Not Who You Say I Am, Who He Says We Are, all right?
Who am I, God the highest King? Who am I?
Thank you, Lord. All right, you may be seated. Thank you.
Yeah. And it's that time for the children to be dismissed to children's church, so all the little ones get over there taught at a level that they can understand, and I want to go with them. Like I said earlier, we have like a double delight today. We've not only had the Wiles family with us leading us in worship, but we have one of our own missionary families that have come back to share with us what God is doing in their lives. Kevin and Maria Martins became a part of our church family, one of the supported missionary families from our church about 15 years ago when they were seeking to go as a small term, short term anyway, not small, short term, missions to Czech Republic, right, in Prague, and we took them on for support and supported them 5-6 years that they were doing that, and now they've kind of transitioned into a different role. They're support missionaries for other Avant missionaries, kind of a member care type ministry that they do, and they're going to come this morning. He's going to he and her or whatever is going to share with us what God's doing in their ministry. They're located now not in the Czech Republic, but in Panama City, Panama, and we continue to support them as a part of our missions family. Let's give Kevin and Maria a welcome today as they share about their ministry, and Kevin preaches to us.
Well, it is always good to be here, and I mean that from the bottom of our heart. You know, coming here, it feels like going to a family reunion, you know, the kind that you want to be at. And I wish, we wish, that we could have been here much sooner, but, you know, COVID and yeah, I feel like 2 years of our lives have been sucked out of us. But we just want to say thank you to you as a church body for your faithfulness to us, your love to us. One of the sound men, I don't even know his name, he recognized us by the front door. I'm going, wow, that is good. So kudos to you. He admitted that, I mean, he's seen videos of us, but, you know, we do watch you from time to time, but we only get to see the back of your heads. And so, you know, maybe if you turned around, that's that person. No, never mind. But we just want to say thank you for your love to us, your faithfulness to us. When we come here, we feel so welcome. And so it's not lost on us. just so you know where we're coming from, we arrived in Canada on Good Friday morning, and since then, after Easter weekend, we took a road trip to out west, Western Canada, and we came back a week later after putting on, I don't know, about 2,600 miles, and we had 3 days or 4 days to just kind of settle before driving to Kansas City for a week for a conference, and now after that we could rest and just chill. So it's just really great to be reconnecting with our kids, which they live up near Steinbach, and our parents. My parents have joined us this morning, so it's just been good. Before I share the message with you, Maria is going to give a brief snapshot of our ministry, because you may wonder, what in the world is member care? So
as member care providers, we get to care for 26 different family units, or 73 people spread throughout 7 different countries. We communicate through texts, video calls, and by visiting them on the field. And then recently, we've been able to visit, travel again and visit on the field, and it's just so much better than a Zoom chat.
Yeah.
So we get to see them face to face. We get to see their so much more, including sharing food with them. Besides our member care role, we're also very much involved in serving in an international church in Panama called Life Bridge. Our role there is they're being in charge of the hospitality ministry. That's my job, organizing our life groups, and preaching from time to time is his job. And we also have been approached by people outside the church for counseling needs and discipleship. We recently became facilitators with a program called Prepare Enrich, and it's just been an incredible tool, and it's like we didn't need to say anything. God whispered in certain couples' ears that there was some help. And so for that, we're grateful, and it keeps us busy, and it keeps us on our knees for these couples, and it's a great privilege. The prayer request that we have for our spiritual well-being and for wisdom to be able to do our job well, ministering to different people, different personalities, different backgrounds, one has to be really and incline the ear really well, first to the Lord and then to our people. For the missionaries that we represent, at any given time, we are walking alongside missionaries who sometimes struggle greatly. Financially, we have, again, lost significant amount in support in the last year. And while this is never fun for us to talk about, we ask the Lord that you join us in prayer for this shortfall to be met. One of the biggest tugs on our hearts is the well-being of our kids. And while they are adults, we miss them terribly, and we ask you to pray for us and for them. Thank you.
Thank you, Maria. You know, as I mentioned earlier, the last couple of months have been really busy, and I wanted today to speak to you on distractions and how they might affect you without even noticing. As I look across the audience, I see that many, like you, wear glasses. And I don't know about you, but I don't pay enough attention to my glasses sometimes. Not as much as I ought to. However, it began in Panama lately. I realized, you know, when I'm reading, I have to try a little harder. When I'm focusing, I'm having to work a little more. And since we've been in Canada, we got our eye exams done. We hadn't had eye exams for 5 years for me, 7 for Maria. And you might be wondering, what in the world, why'd you take so long? And we just got our new glasses. And, you know, these are my old glasses. I brought my old glasses. I haven't worn them for 2 weeks, okay? And you know, why have I waited so long to get my eyes tested? Well, I could blame it on the poor reviews that we heard about optometrists in Panama. I could also blame it on, well, you know, when we do finally get to Winnipeg, it's just really hard to get an appointment with our optometrist, that whom we like very much. But you know what the main reason is? It lies with me. I don't notice the deterioration of my eyesight because when it happens so gradually, I just get used to it. Now, these are my old glasses right here. I haven't, like I said, I haven't worn them for 2 weeks. You right now are a little blurry, a little fuzzy. Okay, that's a little better. But you know what? I notice the scratches. I notice where the film has been scratched off. Now, I put my new glasses on. You all are looking fabulous. All right? I can tell you that. But you know what? 2 weeks ago, I didn't notice, I didn't really know how much better my eyes would be. I take my eyes for granted. And in fact, I take them so for granted that I assume my eyes aren't deteriorating. And if we're not careful, the same thing can happen to us in our spiritual lives, right? If we allow the busyness of life to rob us of our intimacy with Jesus, our busyness can be filled up with good things, really good things. Things like coaching your son's or daughter's hockey team, or your daughter's baseball team. You might be involved in various church activities, teaching Sunday school, teaching Awana, serving on committees, being an usher, whatever it is. These are good things, right? I think we'd all agree. But you know what? Good things, if they become ultimate things, can be destructive things. Good things that become ultimate things can be destructive things. Can we still be a coach on our kids' sports teams? Can we still serve on committees, teach Sunday school, and Awana? Yes, yes, and yes. God wants us to do that, but we need to keep God at the center of our lives because it is out of our relationship that we're empowered to serve. It's through the power of His Spirit working in us and then through us. But how do we receive that power? It's spending time with Jesus. We need time with Him. So how can we have that vibrant relationship with Jesus and be faithful to the end without collapsing? I want to give you two words, with or for. Will we work for Jesus or will we work with Jesus? The gospel is an invitation to walk with Jesus and not for Jesus. But before I read the scripture, which will be Luke 10, let me pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for who you are. You are good and you are great and you are faithful as we sang this morning already. We thank you for your mercy, which is new every morning. We thank you, Lord, that we get to be here together, to worship together. Lord, I ask that you meet us where we're at, and that through your word you would speak to our hearts, and that we would become doers of your word and not just hearers only. And so, Lord, I pray that the meditation of my heart and the words of my mouth would be pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. So turn your Bibles, if you have them, to Luke 10, beginning in verse 38. And it's a story of Mary and Martha. And this story, if you've grown up in church, it's very familiar. Martha is working real hard, of course, and Mary's just so lazy. Right? Luke 10, 38. Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she went up to him and said, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to serve all alone? Tell her then to help me. But the Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary's chosen the good portion which will not be taken away from her. You know, when we read Luke's gospel, we find out why he came and how he came. In Luke 19, Jesus sees Zacchaeus in a tree and invites himself over to his house. Evidently, Zac's time with Jesus is so radical that he promises to change his life completely. And then Jesus says to him, today salvation has come to this house, since he is also a son of Abraham. And then Jesus says, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. This is why he came. And then in Luke 7, after Jesus performs a host of miracles, his reputation, understandable, it spreads like wildfire. Word even reaches John the Baptist, and it causes him to ask his disciples whether or not Jesus is the Messiah. And Jesus responds by telling his disciples to report what they've just seen. He quotes a portion of Isaiah 35 that speaks what will happen when the Messiah does come. The blind will see, the lame will walk, lepers will be cleansed, and the dead will be raised. And then he says to the Pharisees, John came eating no bread, drinking no wine, and they say, he is a demon. The Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, look at him, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. So Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. And in so doing, he ate and drank with them. That's how he came. It's been observed that in Luke's gospel, Jesus is either going to a meal, at a meal, or coming from a meal. Luke 5, Jesus calls Levi, Matthew, a tax collector, to be his disciple. Matthew follows, throws a party where Jesus is the guest of honor. In Luke 7, Jesus is in the home of a Pharisee for a meal, and a woman suddenly becomes the center of attention when she washes Jesus' feet with her tears. In Luke chapter 9, Jesus feeds the 5,000, another meal, big meal. Chapter 11, Jesus eats at a home of another Pharisee who only complains that Jesus didn't wash his hands. Shame on him. Chapter 14, yet at another Pharisee's home, and this Pharisee's laid a trap. It's the Sabbath. And at his home, he's got a man who's got dropsy, and he's waiting to see what Jesus will do. In Luke 22, we have the somber scene of the Last Supper meal that Jesus will have on earth. And here, Jesus institutes the communion meal, and he foretells Judas's betrayal and Peter's denial. In chapter 24, Jesus has two meals. The first is with the two disciples on the road to Emmaus, and then later, Jesus eats some fish in the presence of his disciples just to prove that he's not a ghost. And we find ourselves in chapter 10, where a meal is being prepared in Martha's home. Martha was likely the eldest sister, and it's possibly she owned the house and was wealthy, at least wealthy enough to have a home large enough to host Jesus and the disciples. We don't know if Martha had heard Jesus was in the area, but nevertheless, she welcomes Jesus and his disciples into her home, and she busily begins preparing the food. Meanwhile, Jesus is sitting at Jesus' feet, totally oblivious to Martha's frantic activity. Luke says Martha was distracted, and the Greek word gives the same impression that the English word does. She's pulled away, taken off track, pulled into something else. What are the things that distract you and me? In our day and age, we can't ignore the role of technology. Some of our interactions with technology are good and necessary. In fact, you know, I knew where War Road was or is, but, you know, did I remember where the church was? So, you know, this morning, you know, pulled it up. Okay, yeah, it's right there. Okay, great. This is a good tool. But some of our interactions with technology is not spent in the best way. We spend hours mindlessly scrolling through Instagram, Facebook, and whatever else. I read that on average, people touch these things 2,617 times a day. That's just the average. So obviously there's a whole lot more of touching than the average. Some people hardly touch it at all. And it got me to thinking, How many times do I touch my phone? Probably more than I really want to know. What's happened? Our devices own us. And our smartphones, you know, they're not really made for you. Did you know that? Your smartphones are not really made for you. They're made for profit. iPhone doesn't care if it can help you. Sony doesn't care if their phone will make your life better. They just want to make money. Right? But technology isn't the only thing that distracts us. In our passage today, we see Martha being distracted by her work for Jesus. And in response, Jesus basically says that being with him is more important than working for Jesus. It's often hard for people in ministry to wrap their heads around, hard to live out, missionaries included. In fact, this message is out of my realization that was happening to me. When Maria and I visit missionaries, one of the things, among many, is things that we look out for is, how busy are you? How tired are they? It's surprising sometimes to me. I ask, how are you guys doing? I'm tired and I'm busy. Is that really good? We pay attention to the pulse of their spiritual lives because that's really important. And, you know, to be transparent, my own busyness has been challenging for me as of late. In December, we traveled to Argentina to visit two missionary families over a stretch of 8 days, which was followed by Christmas. We had no trips planned for January, which was due to scheduling. But nevertheless, we were busy with people in Panama. We are involved in counseling, as you heard Maria say. We lead a life group. Plus, I'm asked to preach from time to time, and I preached on January 22nd. And that was during a time when friends from Canada came to visit us, which was great. We loved having them, hosting them. We did, you know, every day we're somewhere doing stuff, seeing the canal and other things. We had a wonderful time. And after they left, we made plans to visit 5 fields in Brazil over a span of 10 days from late February to early March. Again, we had a great time connecting, but we're pouring out constantly, sleeping in different beds, either every night or every other. And on the way back, we spent either 16 hours just getting back to Panama. We left the airport. We arrived at the airport at 1 a.m., got to home at 7 p.m., and so we were exhausted. Then I get hit with a nasty flu. As you can imagine, all that travel, all this stuff, my body just needed to catch up. I recuperate well enough to put a sermon together before Maria's sisters arrive, because they too were spending a week with us, had a great time. We take them to everything and do everything, and it's excellent. Have a great time connecting. But I haven't had time with Jesus like I'd like. And after I preach while they were there, and then the sisters leave, and the last sister leaves. 2 days later, we're on our way to Colombia to visit two missionary families. We had a meaningful time, but when we got back, we had 1 week exactly to come to prepare coming to Canada. And as I said earlier, you know, we arrived Good Friday morning, and the following Monday we went on a road trip. Gone for a week, tons of driving, great connections. We get back, we're home for 4 days, and then we're off to Kansas City for a week-long conference. Lots of driving, lots of sitting. Good conference. But, you know, I'm having all of this in mind after we get back from Colombia, and I'm thinking I have to prepare something for April 30th. The conference is over on the 28th. We drive all day 29th, so I have to be ready because the next morning I'm preaching. So, Lord, what am I going to preach on? I had no idea. And to be honest, I was not in a good spiritual state to even think of what I should be preaching on. So I listened. I thought, well, maybe if I plug in some music, you know, that'll help get the juices flowing, get some of my thoughts, and I'll be able to hear the Lord. And instead of pressing some music, I listened to a sermon. I don't know how it happened. I just listened to a sermon instead. And the sermon barely started, and I feel like, oh my goodness, this feels wonderful. It's like the Lord is pouring a big old cup of water into my soul. And I realized just how empty I was. It brought me to tears. Not because of what was said, but the realization just how empty I was. Oh, wow, does this feel awesome. God is pouring into my life right now, and I can't miss this. This is just so fantastic. And I was in tears because I was so empty. I enjoyed the sermon so much, I listened to another. The content, I'll be honest, wasn't as great as it was the first time, but the results were still the same. It was just like, oh, God, you're so good. You're just pouring into my heart right now. It's amazing. Boy, did I miss this. And I realized we'd been doing good things, good stuff, visiting missionaries, hosting people in our home. It was good things, but I was working for Jesus and not with Jesus because I hadn't spent time with him. Where are you this morning? Have you spent time with Jesus? Are there any distractions that are standing in the way? When I look at our passage in Luke 10, I see at least five things that happen, that can happen when we live our lives detached from the presence and power of Jesus. Number one, we worry. Sitting in our living room after getting back from Columbia, I was worried about what I should preach on. I was worried. When will I have time to finish? Because, we got these road trips. We won't have time. I was worried. And when we live apart from the abiding presence of Jesus, we forget that God is sovereign and he's got us. When we live apart from his abiding presence, I live as though everything is up to me. Because I've forgotten God, the creator of the universe who upholds all things by the word of his power. That's in Hebrews 1. And when we forget that, anxiety builds and we feel like we're losing control. And life with Jesus will calm our anxiety while working for Jesus will make you feel as though everything depends on you. And so we worry when we're not with Jesus. When we need peace in our lives, we need to rest in the Prince of Peace. Jesus said himself in John chapter 5 that he could do nothing apart from the Father. So any disconnect we have in our intimacy with him will often cause us to relapse into anxiety and fear and frustration. And in other words, we find peace in the person of Jesus. This is why Jesus said in John 15 verse 4, "Abide in me and I in you as a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me." On the topic of fruit bearing, you and I can do many things, but we cannot make fruit. We can only bear fruit. Fruit does not come through trying really hard, but it grows from the life source. Just think about the next time you go to the grocery store and you pick up a cluster of grapes. That cluster of grapes, the little vine that you've got, will not produce any more grapes. You've just got grapes. And if you leave them on the counter long enough, you'll be eating raisins, right? And that's no bueno for me. Number two, when we are living for Jesus and not with Jesus, We tend to blame others for our problems. Can you just imagine Mary just sitting intently by Jesus, absorbing everything he says like a sponge? Then all of a sudden, Martha barges in. You know, if you look at the dictionary word for hissy fit, you'd probably see a picture of Martha. Jesus, my sister, tell her to help me. She's not doing anything. We blame others, right? Lord, it's not fair. I shouldn't have to do all the work. Tell her to help me. When we're living for Jesus and not with Jesus, we're detached from his life and we get tired. We get exhausted. We complain and then we resent others because life feels unfair. And then we start feeling like a victim. A victim mentality deflects the responsibility for one's own behavior while viewing themselves as a victim of someone else's actions. I'm doing all the work. It's not fair. And if we're not careful, we can carry on this attitude toward our relationship with God when, number three, we begin to think that God doesn't care about us. Martha says, Lord, don't you care? My sister's left me to do all the work. When we live detached from the life of Jesus, we lose perspective, and Martha has the audacity to accuse Jesus of not caring. Have you ever felt that God doesn't care about you? That he doesn't love you because you feel forgotten? You know, if you're in that place today, I just want to reassure you, God is crazy about you. It's against his nature not to care for you because 1 John 4:8, John writes, God is love. That's his character. So if you feel forgotten, I hope that you would be convinced that God does love you. That's who he is. And Jesus cares deeply about Martha in her situation, and he cares for you. Matthew 11:28, Jesus invites all those who are weary and burdened, and he will give them rest. And then he says to take his yoke and learn from him, because Jesus is gentle and humble, and we'll find rest for our souls because his yoke is easy and his burden light. Easy and light are not two words many people would use to describe their walk with God. We live in a broken world, it's true. Bad things happen. We experience storms in our lives, and it feels anything but light. And Jesus doesn't promise a life of smooth sailing. We know that. But he does promise that the work that he gives us, when done through his power, becomes easy and light. He has promised never to leave you or forsake you. And so besides feeling as though God doesn't care, the fourth thing that happens when we live outside of the presence of Jesus, we judge others as failures or lazy because they don't live up to the same busy life that we do. In verse 40, Martha says, Lord, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to serve all alone? Martha isn't just mad at God, she's mad at her sister for not helping, and she uses a word that demonstrates the emptiness that comes from independent living, from performance-based value system. She uses the word alone. Alone is not only how anxiety will make you feel, but it'll also how it will make you live, independent from everybody else, because they couldn't do it as good as you could. There's a fifth thing that we see from Martha in this passage. She tells God what to do. Can you imagine telling Jesus, the second member of the Trinity, what to do? And yet that's what Martha does. Tell her to help me. You know, if I'm being honest with myself and I think about the prayers that I have prayed in the past, sometimes I do the same thing. I tell God my solutions. Oh God, oh, would you just straighten out this person? Would you just tell our kids what to do here? Maybe you're looking for a spouse. Oh God, tell that person he should marry me. God, I really want this job. Give me that promotion. God, I really deserve this vacation. I need to go on vacation. I need the money. Are we telling God our answers? Is that how we pray? You know, in preparing this message, it really got me to think, how am I praying? Am I telling God what to do? Why is being with Jesus more important than working for Jesus? It's because life apart from the abiding presence of Jesus while working for him produces worry, exhaustion, anxiety. And Jesus doesn't want that. There's an old hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus, and the line says, what a friend we have in Jesus, oh, what peace we often forfeit, oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. You know, it's not about what you do. It's about who you're with. And Jesus says, Martha, Martha. Pay attention when a name is mentioned twice in Scripture. It's serving as a wake-up call. It's saying something important's about to go down. Moses is about 80 years old and is tending his father-in-law's sheep in the desert. And he sees a burning bush, catches his attention, and he gets close. Moses, Moses. And Moses would become a leader of a people, leading them out of Egypt. In Acts, while on the road to Damascus, Saul is blinded by a great light. He's on his way to persecute Christians when all of a sudden he hears the word, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Such a transformation happens. And Paul becomes the defender of the church. And so much of the New Testament we owe to him because of God's transforming work. When Jesus hung on the cross and he's about to die, he says, my God, why have you forsaken me? And a few moments later, he would breathe his last and he would say, it is finished. And the veil of the temple was torn in two. And so significant was that happening. A new way to God was opened up before us. And in this moment here, Jesus says, Martha, Martha. And I can just very well imagine that he's not shouting at her. He's not condemning her. He's not shaming her. But in compassion, Martha, Martha. Jesus is about to tell her something really important, that if she would just listen, it might just change her life. And the same might be true for us. Because you know what this is all about? It's about our busyness, our anxiety, our worry, and our fears distracting us from being with Jesus. The very things that distract you from being with Jesus are the very things that keep you from experiencing the peace of Jesus. Is God calling your name twice? So what should we do? Should we consign ourselves to a monastery and eliminate all distractions? We can't do that. Can't eliminate everything. But in Philippians chapter 4, beginning in 5b, Paul writes, the Lord is at hand. Ponder that. The Lord is at hand. Don't be anxious about everything, anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Paul says, the peace of God. We can have the peace of God in the midst of the craziness. And that peace of God won't make any sense to those who don't know Jesus. God wants to give you a peace that the world does not know. the peace of God during the pressures of life, and you're not, if you're not experiencing that, you might be too distracted. And here's the thing. The work Martha was doing was necessary. As the owner of the house living in the first century, culture demanded that she show hospitality. And she had a lot of work to do. I mean, there was her, Mary, Jesus, and 12 disciples. So that's at least 15 people that she has to tend to. But here's the thing. Martha fails to see the purposes of God because she's focused on the activity. We need to see that our lives are more about purpose rather than activity. The Westminster Catechism asks the first question, what is the chief end of man? And the answer is simple, to glorify God and enjoy him forever. That's your purpose, to glorify him, to make much of God. When we fall into the trap of working for Jesus like Martha did, how do you think it affects your witness and mine? When we're so consumed with our busyness, can others see Jesus in me and in you? Would they be interested in following the one we say we follow? What would happen if we took all of the energies we use worrying about things we can't control and turn those energies into worship? Worshiping the one who controls all things. Are there worries that you need to bring to Jesus? Your kids, your grandkids, your finances, your physical health? Are there things that scare you that cause you to grab your phone or computer just so you can try and numb out? Martha is working. Mary is worshiping. Mary's not singing, but she is worshiping. Because worship is about the heart. Worship says, we're not the center of the universe. In essence, it's getting off the throne of our lives and putting Jesus there. Worship involves a turning from ourselves toward God. In worship, we express our thankfulness for his grace, mercy, and his faithfulness. And I think Paul may have provided the best definition found in the Bible about worship. Romans 12:1. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual act of worship. If we allow distractions to pull us away from worship, we might not notice how subtly the heart starts to drift. Just like the smudges and scratches on my glasses, I didn't realize were there until, especially when I put on my new glasses. Wow, it's a drastic difference. You know, the smudges on my glasses became second nature. And sometimes the appetites of our flesh and the affections of the world, they creep into our lives in a way that we don't even notice. And they, just over time, it just becomes normal. And our passion for God fades into apathy and indifference toward others. COVID forced us to watch church online. And I was really grateful that at least we had that option. In Panama, we were just talking about it back there earlier. For 7 months, I could go out of the house twice a week for up to 2 hours. To the grocery store or to the pharmacy, and Maria could go out 3 times a week, but not together. We had different days. 3 times a week, up to 2 hours. And we live in an apartment on the 9th floor, and it's about, I'd say, 1,000 square feet or so. It's really tiny. So you better like each other. And we do, so it's awesome. But, I'll be honest, it was tough mentally, because we didn't know when it was going to end. But we enjoyed watching church online. But you know what? There's nothing like worshiping together as a body of believers. You know, just being here this morning has been really special. Sadly, the pandemic has made people a lot of people just keep on their pajamas and watch online, or worse yet, stop going to church altogether. And it's heartbreaking. And some people are not even aware of the spiritual drift that has taken place. Worship is more than music. It is spiritual warfare. It is an exercise and a practice we must continue to do. Martha is working hard for Jesus, and Mary is sitting with Jesus. Mary is a worshiper. Ever, you know, maybe after this you'll go out for lunch, you'll treat your mom out for lunch, and someone you know will come up to you, "How was the worship?" You ever get that question? How was the worship? And very often, that's code for, did they sing your favorite songs? And or was your favorite leader leading the singing? Did the band play all right? How was the worship? You know, that's the wrong question. The question ought to be, how was your worship? How was your worship? You know, I confess, I've sat in services, and the singing is fantastic, but I'm distracted. You know, no one else can give God your affection and praise. Only you can do that. Worship is the only thing you can give God. Worship is spiritual warfare. There is a war for the center of your soul, and the enemy would like very much for us to stay busy and distracted, to live a lukewarm life leading to apathy. But Jesus says, you know what's better? Be with me. Let me share the resources of heaven with you. When we worship God, we're demonstrating a spiritual defiance against the world and the flesh that pulls us away to worship, pulls us to worship self. Worship is the pursuit of God that breaks us free from apathy and fans into flame the embers of our soul. Worship is deliberately bringing our presence into God's presence. And even though Martha is right there, she can't worship because she's distracted. And the thing is, she's not distracted by bad things, but with good things, and it robbed her of intimacy. The writer of Hebrews tells us in chapter 12, 1 and 2, to lay aside every weight and sin. Every weight and sin. There's two things. And let us run the race with endurance. We understand not to allow sin to trip us up, but it also implies that even good things can distract us. And as we said earlier, when good things become ultimate things, they become destructive things. And so Mary chooses what is better. Distracted? Anxious? Worried? How's your worship? Is Jesus speaking your name twice? We, you know, today we honor mothers, and rightfully so. But God is your Father, and He loves you so very much. He's not shouting your name. He's not condemning you. He's not shaming you. He's not trying to guilt you into anything. But He just wants a relationship because He loves you. Isaiah, writing to a people who are facing bad times, the Jews thought, God forgot about us. God speaks to Isaiah. Could a mother ever forget their nursing child? No way. Far be, even if they could, I have etched your name in my hands. God is crazy about you, and He just wants a relationship. Brother Lawrence wrote a small but challenging book called Practicing the Presence of God, and in it, Brother Lawrence shares one of life's deepest secrets to developing one's relationship with God. The secret to him, for him, was God is everywhere. God watches, He listens, and He speaks, and we only need to slow down enough to notice. The devil distracts, and God interrupts. And for some reason, we become victims to the one and grow oblivious to the other. But Brother Lawrence found the most simple remedy to reverse this feeling. He speaks about a companionship with Jesus that is without boundary, not in time or place or in circumstance. Brother Lawrence, if you didn't know, washed a lot of dishes in a monastery. He carried out menial tasks. He scrubbed and wiped other people's messes. But when you read his little book, you get a sense that even in the midst of the clanking of plates, the mopping up of stains off the floor and wiping off splattered greasy backsplashes and dishes, this humble servant was likely the most joyful man in the house because he was delighted to be in the presence of Jesus. Let's pray. Oh, Father God, we thank you for your great love for us. Thank you for being a God who wants relationship, who invites us into relationship with you. Thank you, Jesus, for making that all possible by dying on the cross and saying, "It is finished." A way into the holy place was made for us. We thank the Holy Spirit also for being the member of the Trinity who's in us and with us and empowers us. And I pray, Father, that you would empower your people here to bring you glory. And I pray, Father, that each of us would just take time to be with Jesus, to be more mindful of the things in our lives that distract us, that pull us away. Help us to be more mindful of Jesus. Thank you so much for this beautiful group of people, this church, this body. Bless them richly. Thank you for the work they're doing in the kingdom and in this community. And may you be glorified in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Wow. Kevin challenged us today with God's word about being distracted. And wow, it has been a challenge. I'd like to invite the ushers to come. We're going to receive an offering for Kevin and Maria as part of our church family. Just a love offering to let them know that we appreciate them and them partnering with us to share God's love around the world. So encourage you as we sing our last and closing song to just give as God leads you. And parents, you can be dismissed to go pick up your kids at this time as well. Appreciate that. Let's pray. Father, we thank you and praise you for your word and for your servant that brought it today. Lord, help us to be careful that we don't continue to do things for you, but with you. And Lord, this morning we want to receive a special love offering for Kevin and Maria and their lives and their ministry and for them as a family. And God, I just pray that you'd bless the gift as well as the giver. We'll be careful to thank you and praise you for all this we ask in Christ's name. Amen. God bless as you give.
You know, I was paying very close attention to the message this morning about distraction. And I'll be honest, for many years, one of my biggest distractions was something that you've all heard of called the Xbox. Okay? And for years...
Don't worry, he's been redeemed.
For years, that was a distraction of mine that I had. And the devil lies to us and says, it's okay, you need you time. You need you time, okay? And maybe, you know, after a hard day of work or after a hard week or whatever, the devil's telling you, you need you time. When in all reality, we need him time. And so if you're going through distractions and if you're going through voices that are telling you to take you time, it's not about you. It's about him. And I know the guy doing the media is going to dislike me right now because the whole way through the sermon, the Lord was telling me to close with a different song. And we don't have the words for this. It's an older song. If you know it, sing with me. If you don't, worship the Lord. Spend some time with God. Maybe even have a time of prayer. But maybe you've heard this song, and it goes like this.
when the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come. Longing just to bring something that's worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, to the way things appear. You're looking into my heart.
Sing this together.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about
him. Have a great week.